A lot of Western New Yorkers are digging through the coupons after Bed Bath & Beyond announced its closing. We told you how the company's bankruptcy will be happening over the next couple of months. Here on the Town Hall tonight, we want to dig into the bigger picture and what this says about all those big box stores. First, what you need to know right now, Bed Bath & Beyond will start winding down operations and will liquidate its assets. The stores, the website, and Bye Bye Baby locations will remain open long enough so they can sell off what they can. Our Dave McKinley reminisced with shoppers today outside the McKinley Mall location.
They always had a coupon. They always accepted the coupon. You could wrap your presents for free. Customer service, excellent. It's just sad. You look at this whole mall and it's like, what's left?
Well, for shoppers, the big sales start this Wednesday. If you have reward points or any gift cards, you need to use those by May 8th. And the company anticipates closing all of its stores by the end of June. Joining us now is Mark Matthews, Vice President of Research, Development and Industry Analysis with the National Retail Federation, which is, of course, the world's largest retail trade association. Mark, we appreciate you taking some time for us. And it's interesting when you look through the numbers here, your group is predicting retail sales will grow between 4% and 6% this year, surpassing $5 trillion. We hear that, but what is the disconnect between that growth overall and then this trend that we're seeing, especially with it seems like the big box stores either closing or at least struggling?
Well, first of all, thank you so much for having me. I think there isn't any disconnect here. I think there's a tendency in retail to focus on, the negatives, because when, companies go bankrupt, particularly when retailers go bankrupt, people notice, right? Because these are businesses that we interact with. So the reality of the matter is that, we've seen about 1,800 stores closed so far this year. We've seen about 2,700 stores open this year. So more stores are opening than closing. We actually have more stores now than we have ever had at any point in the US. And, we're running below the normal rate for bankruptcy as well. But like I said, when a retailer does go bankrupt, people tend to notice and it makes news.
Yeah, closing may seem more newsworthy than an opening, even though both are significant. Back to your forecast there of growth for this year. What then is behind that? I mean, are there certain subsections of the industry, certain chains, certain types of shopping that are pushing up the numbers that are maybe doing better than most other sectors?
Yeah, so I mean, it's important to understand that, we are coming off of a phenomenal 3-year period for retail sales. We've seen retail sales, we've seen 8 years of growth packed into the last 3 years, $1.5 trillion worth of growth in the last 2 years. But what we are seeing now when we're projecting 4% to 6% growth for 2023 is sort of a return to normal, right? Behaviors are starting to return to normal where going on holiday again, we're eating out, we're going to movies. So as the consumer returns to normal, in some of those areas where we were overspending, we're probably gonna see a little bit less spend. But in some areas where, for example, returning to work, more people buying suits and dresses and office attire as opposed to comfy homewear. So there are gonna be areas that do really well as a result of the change in consumer behavior. And the same token, some areas that are going to do a little bit less well.
We always have this conversation about in-person shopping versus online, which just keeps growing and growing. But we did just cover the opening of Primark here in Western New York last week. This international chain, it only does in-store, traditional brick and mortar. And your report shows that's still a big chunk of sales, right? Still making up 70% of what we spend in terms of retail. How are we looking right now? In-person shopping versus online?
Well, there's still a big desire to shop in person. We saw, once the pandemic started fading away, a lot of people rushing back into stores, because remember, shopping isn't just a transactional behavior. Shopping is something that Americans do for fun, for entertainment, with their families. So it's not just about, going out there to buy things. So I think, brick and mortar is here to stay, and it's important to recognize that brick and mortar and e-commerce tend to work hand in hand. Some of the areas where we're seeing the fastest e-commerce growth tends to be things like buy online, pick up in store, and curbside pickup, where the store is a very important part of the transaction. And also, you know, when you order things to your home, in many cases, those might be fulfilled from your local store. So the role of the store is changing, but it's still a really important part of the industry.
Very interesting perspective. Mark Matthews is a vice president with the National Retail Federation. Thanks for coming on today. We appreciate it.
Thank you so much for having me.